demand schedule is a relationship between the price and the quantity demanded of the good, right? So once we have these numbers, which is giving us the different quantity that is demanded of a good at different prices, at these various prices, we can now represent this in a graph. And for that, we place the price of the good on the y-axis and the quantity on the x-axis. So all we do now is plot this graph. So when the price is $0 up here, what is the quantity demanded of this good? Well, it's 16, so we'll start at this point. And so we'll plot all these points that have been provided to us, depending upon, in this case, we are looking at Helen's demand. And once we have these points, we will then have what we refer to as a demand schedule. So a line going through all these points gives us the demand for Helen, and the product that we're thinking about in this case of this example is for chewing gums. So this is an individual demand curve, all right? And what do we assume when we draw this graph? Well, we assume everything else that can influence the quantity demanded is constant. So anything else that can influence it, income, preferences, price of other goods, related goods, and so on. So we assume all those things are constant and all those things have been kept fixed when we look at and explore this relationship between price and quantity demanded. Okay, so with this, we come to the law of demand. And what does that state? Well, it's really highlighting the negative relationship between the price and the quantity demanded, or the fact that the demand function is downward sloping or has a negative slope. Yeah? So the lower the price of a good, let's look at the last statement, the lower the price of a good, the larger is the quantity demanded. So now we'll derive the demand, the market demand. So you want to now aggregate the individual demand functions and come up with a market demand. Now the question is, how do we sum up these individual demand functions? And this is something that we call horizontal summation, and you'll see why it is called a summation, a horizontal summation. Now let's think about two individuals, okay? And this applies to if we have more than two individuals as well. So we are taking the same individual's demand function from before, Helen, and now we're adding another individual, Ken. Okay? So in this case, we have two individuals and we want to derive the market demand. Yeah, let's just suppose that there are only two individuals in the market. So when we look at the market demand, we actually aggregate over all individuals. So the question then arises, well, at this price, P is equal to 1. Yeah? What is the market demand? Well, the market demand is this individual's demand, 14, plus this individual's demand, Gens, which is 7, and that gives us a market demand. Yeah? So let's do that for all the different prices. Price equal to 0, we have 24. And so we add up the individual demands, and that would give us the market demand. And because quantity is measured on the horizontal axis, and that's what we are summing up, it is referred to as horizontal summation. You remember, right? When we drew the graph earlier, price was the y-axis and quantity was the x-axis. So here we have the demand function, and we have this market demand schedule, which we are going to draw on this graph, where we are measuring price on the y-axis and quantity on the x-axis. And once we plot this, we see that the market demand also is downward sloping. Yeah. Now, what can change demand? Again, I would like to emphasize that we're now referring to the demand, not quantity demanded. So quantity demanded is changed only by the change in the price of that good. Okay. Demand, on the other hand, which is this relationship, quantity demanded and the price, that depends upon a lot of factors. Okay. Now, change in quantity demanded is really a movement along the demand function. What that means is, well, we drew this demand function by asking the question, when the prices change, how does the quantity demand change, right? So if we change the prices, the quantity demand change is actually measured by going along this demand function, and hence a movement along the demand curve. And if there is a change in all those factors that we assumed were constant when we drew this demand function, if any of those changes, there's going to be a shift in the demand function. The demand either increases, that means it the whole function shifts to the right, or it decreases, that means it shifts to the left. Let's look at some of the factors here. So if there's a change in the price of related goods, then we would see that there has been a shift in the demand function. Expected future prices, income, expected future income, access to credit, change in population. Well, this one is easy, so let me just discuss this one first. Population increase. Well, market demand is an aggregate of all individual demands, right? So if there's an increase in population, that means there are now more individual demands to be added to that market demand. So your market demand would shift to the right, yeah? Because now there's more demand. And then we'll have preferences as well. Okay, so let's take an example of video games, right? So we're looking at two consoles. We are looking at the Wii and the Xbox. Yeah? Now, as far as our products are concerned, these two are substitutes. Either we can use the Wii console or we can use the Xbox. So those are substitutes. Now, what about Xbox games? Well, you need games to be able to use your Xbox consoles. Remember, guys, the product that we are looking at here in this case is the Xbox. I can't seem to figure. Go back to the slide, but what we're looking at here. So let's look at one of the examples. Now the example here is of Xbox console. So suppose we have a demand function for this, yeah? And now we want to consider what are the substitute, what are the other products, and price of which is going to affect the demand for this good. So Wii consoles are a substitute. If the price of a Wii falls, they are more likely to buy the Wii, and the demand for Xbox would fall. Yeah? So these are substitutes, so these are related products. What about Xbox games? Like, hello. Now, these games are played on this console, so these are complements. They go together. Remember, the product that we are thinking about right now, the good that we're thinking about right now, is the Xbox console, right? So this is a complement for this product. And so what would happen if the price of the game falls? Well, then people are more likely to buy Xbox consoles because the games are much cheaper. Okay. So when the price of a substitute rises, then we would see an increase in the demand for Xbox and vice versa for the Xbox games. And expected future prices. Well, if we expect the price to rise in the future, then we are very likely to purchase a good right now. So there would be an increase in the demand for the good at current time. What about income? Well, if we have more income, then we can afford more. So at the same price, we're more likely to increase demand. And in that case, we would see a shift in the demand function to the right. Now, when you think about income, there are distinctions between different types of goods. If with increase in income, our demand increases, then we generally refer to that as a normal good. Whereas an inferior good is when our income increases, we buy less of that good. Yeah? Can you think of an example? Well, maybe to some extent, secondhand items. If we have more income, we are more likely to buy new items and we would decrease our demand for secondhand goods. For some people, secondhand goods is not really an inferior good because they are thinking about the environment, but hopefully you get the picture about the inferior goods. And then, of course, expected future income and credit. At times, our income hasn't increased right now, but we expect to get this fantastic job and we'll have a very high future income. And what an expectation of having higher income will start increasing our demand right now. Yeah? So we'll see an increase in demand in that case as well. And population, as I mentioned, because there is going to be more demand by more individuals, there's going to be a shift in the demand function or increase in the demand function. What about preferences? Well, again, it's going to have the same effect as income. People prefer, the preferences for a good increases, hence there's be an increase in demand for that good. Okay. And so let's go back to our initial example, which was for energy bars. Now, this is a graph that we have, the market demand. And now let's suppose that there is increase in income. What would happen to this relationship? Well, what we see, observe here is that at price is equal to 2, this is a demand for these bars right now, energy bars. Yeah. And at this price, $3, the demand is roughly 5 millions of bars. As the price decreases, the demand increases. Well, more and more people will enter the market and start purchasing the goods. So we see that quantity demanded is increasing. I'm sorry, I should refer to that as quantity demanded increases. Now, as the price falls, quantity demanded increases. Now, what happens when there's an increase in income? Well, then more people can afford and can pay a higher price. So at $250, instead of these many goods being bought, there's going to be a larger amount of goods that are going to be bought or demanded. Yeah. So the whole demand function in this case is going to shift to the right. So increase in income would lead to a shift in the demand to the right. So for the and you can double check this answer or to double check whether this shift is shift makes sense. For the same price, $2, the quantity demanded is much higher for the red graph. Yeah? So that is what the shift is. Right? Now, we discussed this in class as well, but just to make sure that we remember this, another way of thinking about this demand function is demand curve is also to think of this as what is the maximum we are willing to pay for a good. Okay. And so in that sense, what you see here as price, we can also think of this as the marginal benefit. What is the benefit of consuming that extra unit? Okay, it's marginal, which means an increase in unit at the margin, and that would be the lowest number. So if quantity or increases by one unit, what is the increase in benefit? That is referred to as marginal benefit, and it decreases as we consume more, or it is higher when we are consuming less of the good. And generally speaking, we are going to be referring to these terms, market where the buyers and sellers are going to interact, a competitive market where the number of buyers and number of sellers are really large in numbers, so much so that each individual buyer or seller has no influence on the market price. Okay. And money price as compared to relative prices, money prices in absolute amount, how much does a good cost? $3.